Thank you, Ambassador. The multi-vector model is a nice connotation. Unfortunately, it cannot be applied to Georgia for several quite perfectly understandable reasons. A chunk of the country remains under Russian occupation, which naturally prevents Tbilisi from adopting a truly multi-vector approach. That said, even if we speak about a policy of multi-vector minus one, which is the occupying power, it still might be conceivable. Yet even if such policies pursued, Georgia's path would still differ greatly from the balancing acts pursued by Kazakhstan and Azerbaijan. It's obvious that Tbilisi steadfastly pursues formal Euro-Atlantic integration with all possible emphasis and without any meaningful caveats. But all this does not, of course, deny the importance of stability and cooperation in the South Caucasus, within the wider Black Sea region and in relation to the Black Sea and Caspian macro region. Georgia's contribution to the cross-border cooperation and regional development are premised on the country's role as a pivot for various major international projects, whose geopolitical and financial viability Tbilisi tries to ensure. A multi-vector policy should therefore not be seen as purely outbound in nature, which means Georgia versus major regional stakeholders, but must also include inbound elements that stem from the genuine interest of stakeholders in their own domestic stability and order. It also provides for the vital interests of regional actors such as Azerbaijan and Kazakhstan with respect to Georgian reforms and close integration with Western markets and institutions. This very high degree of interconnectedness and interdependence demonstrates all the realities of geopolitics and geoeconomics in the Black Sea and Caspian region, and indeed underlines the importance to make those ties even stronger and more resilient. Combined with the region's long history and the looming challenges of our post-pandemic world, Georgia must position herself as a key actor capable of providing reliable access to the wider world and to the West while bypassing political bumps and risks. A G-world in which each country selfishly stands up for its own interests and ignores others would not just be ill-suited to our region, but would also completely and irreversibly shatter the idea of furthering our interests in union or alliances with others. Georgia progress is equally important for the United States and the European Union. It is no accident or coincidence that both Washington and Brussels variously praised Tbilisi as a valuable and key partner in the region. These objectives clearly underline Georgia's foreign policy choices and come as no surprise considering the pace and ambition of the country's agenda for rapprochement with European Union. In terms of Georgia's relationships with Europe, it is encouraging to observe how the country is building new political, economic, and cultural ties with its European homeland. How new EU and Eastern partnership initiatives are tangibly bringing more Europe to the region. As for US-Georgia ties, the two countries' strategic partnership charter is truly a unique constitutional document that sets out many ways in which Washington and Tbilisi can cooperate politically, economically, culturally, and militarily. Beyond this, the standalone bipartisan Georgian Act, Support Act, reinforces and expands America's unwavering support for Tbilisi and determination to oppose Russian occupation. In many respects, this act reminds me of the Wallace Declaration with respect to the Baltic states under the occupation. It also, we should also keep in mind, you know, the National Defense Authorization Act, which defines various meaningful forms of U.S.-Georgia cooperation, as well as the Consolidated Appropriations Act, and the 2016 Memorandum, deepening defense and security partnership, becomes a framework agreement that was renewed in 2019. The House and Senate have, in addition, introduced dozens of resolutions and bills in support of Georgia and preliminary discussions to open negotiations over a free trade agreement between two countries are underway. I should emphasize that the United States are, of course, not a Black Sea or Caspian country, but are to some extent already a Black Sea power. All the efforts and steps I've described go well beyond the purely bilateral format, and their ultimate goals are to promote the region's stability and prosperity, responding to the needs of the region region's various members and meeting the expectations of the relevant stakeholders. If there ever was a cause and purpose that we had to share together, this is it. Thank you, Ambassador, and I would of course be delighted to answer any questions the audience may have. Thank you.